save Q&A on that until the end. I want to introduce George Niehouse, who's going to give us his wonderful paper on bullets in baseball. And I remember when I first received this paper, I was stricken by the way it explores such a heavy topic as war from a really playful angle, and sort of just reminded me that soldiers are people too and have this whole need for recreation and blowing off of steam and maybe some distraction from war. And so I really enjoyed your paper for that reason, and I can't wait to hear all about it.
I'm going to put some pictures up, and hopefully we can do this. Yes? There we go. I think. Well, that'll work. That'll work. Well, I think up is where I want up. So let's come over here.
This is the scroll.
Yes.
And the mouse is kind of.
Yeah, John set up a. All right, let's go up just a little bit.
I think it'll go up for you,
Annie. We got two different. Oh, there we go.
Yeah.
There we go. That'll work. Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. I want to say, first of all, this is an honor and a privilege to be here, and quite unexpected. And the next thing I want to say is, Rachel, what a fantastic presentation. That was great. Thank you very much. And before I start with bullets and baseball, there are some people I need to thank. First off, it'd be Catherine Lackman in the Gateway Program. If it had not talked to Catherine 4.5 years ago, this paper would not be here, okay? I would not be here. Marianne Tuitu was my first instructor, and she is still instructing me to this day, whether she knows it or not. Angela Galick, if I had not been lucky enough to get into her class, again, this paper would not be here. She gave me plenty of support, and she gave me ideas, and I did not know how I could write. And I still don't know that I can write. But Joanna Carter, who has, well, over the past 3 weeks, given me constructive criticism on how to present a paper. And my academic advisor, Rhonda Macy. A little story first about Rhonda. 4.5 years ago, I completed HVAC courses, and then I kind of lost track. I became involved with RRCC in the housekeeping department, and well, I'd be here around 5 o'clock, and I'd be, after I discovered the library and novels, I'd be reading outside of the advising section. And one day, Rhonda stopped by, and she asked, well, how many of these do you read a week? And I said, geez, I don't know, one, maybe 1 to 3. And then she went and asked a question, do you have a degree? And then it was all over but the shouting. There's no way that I could not, working at a college, get a degree. And that is now the incarnation of George. And without those people, this paper would not be here. And with that, baseball, or one of its incarnations, was around well before 1861 and the Civil War. But the Civil War popularized this game and rocketed it on its way to what became our national pastime. And just as it helped those soldiers in that insanity, it helped me, and the impression that it left on me through many, many tough times that I had as an individual. Now, it's been said that there's many parallels between baseball and war. And as an example, George Kirsch found an article from 1857 in the New York Clipper, and it states, players will be compelled to lay by their weapons of war, enter into winter quarters, there to discuss and lay plans for the proper conducting of next year's campaign. Now, without the word player in there, you could add combat troops. Now, people in the Civil War, the troops in the Civil War, did not relish winter campaigns. The reason being is that on both sides, everybody thought that they would win this war in 3 months. So they sent them off to war with sometimes lacking shoes, lacking proper clothing. They did give them plenty of guns and plenty of bullets. Well, the war didn't last 3 months. And baseball is kind of the same way. If you ever played baseball in temperatures of 30 degrees, well, if you didn't square up on the ball that was thrown and you hit it with the bat, it felt like you got 10,000 bees in your hands. And of course, it's tough to run in the wintertime. Now, in the springtime, when movement is conducive to armies, now it's also conducive to playing baseball, and the soldiers did not look forward to playing or going into war at that time against bullets, but they did look forward to playing baseball, and that war between the chalk lines on the infield. Now, baseball played an important part in to keep a man's mind focused on something besides death and destruction. You can lose yourself in the competition for hours and hours on end. And when playing ball, it's almost impossible to think of anything else. And if you do think of something else, you're liable to get your noggin knocked, kind of like going into battle. You need your concentration to stay alive. Now, Johnny Boggs kind of illustrates this in his historical novel, Camp Ford. Baseball helped men forget that the tree line used as a home run fence might be hiding 15,000 enemy troops that want to get up close and personal with you the next morning. Now, troop commanders, too, realized early on that baseball was a genuine morale booster. And they did the best they could to provide what was needed. And what was needed, basically, was bats and balls. That's all they used at that time. If you got a uniform, that was really special. And the thing about this, if it could be provided, that'd be great. Factory made is fine, but you could make this equipment in the field, and they did that often. Now, if you had some horse hide, some horse hair for the stitching, some wool and a cork center, there you got a ball. And if there was a tree nearby, and of course, that part of the country, there's plenty of trees. You just go cut off a branch and get your whittling knife out, make yourself a bat, play ball. And that sort of thing kind of made me feel special too when something was provided. I played my first organized baseball game in 1963. It's a little over 100 years after the war ended in Conway, Missouri, which was not a major battleground, but it's kind of ironic that the Civil War did exist there. And I got to put on a uniform of sorts. Got a t-shirt, but they made me a catcher. And I got shin guards, which of course I put on wrong, and I only fell down once. And a chest protector and a mask and a glove that was so big at the time, because you know, you're 8 years old, every time the ball hit it, like it fell off. But the thing was, it made me feel special. It made me forget about the abject poverty I was living in at the time. I mean, poverty wasn't as bad as war, but life wasn't much fun at the time. And baseball gave me a ticket to another world. And Boggs said it, too. Time passes quicker when there's baseball, and you don't have to think about anything else. Donald Honig reflects, there were no team sports in America until baseball was developed. That baseball had a catalyzing effect, bringing people together first in teams, then the crowds that surrounded the unfenced grounds, and there was something about the new game. Its tempo, its balance, its potential for individual excellence amid team unity. The same as going into an army. You can have heroes in your troop, but it takes a team to pull everybody through. But as appealing as it was, baseball developed from its beginnings as a gentleman's game. Some people from New York and Boston area, the elite of the country at the time, the people that had the money, the time to make up the rules as they went, well, that was the gentleman's game. And then a war broke out. Men and boys came from all over the country, either volunteering for the armies or through the draft. And the idea of gentlemen went out the window, because these guys, you know, again, from urban centers, from the country, from everything in between, well, they made up an army, and then they made up baseball teams. And it's amazing how our society sees individual accomplishments as a driving force, and yet there's baseball, where an individual actions and individual's actions benefit the team. It seems to me that this particular thing, or the particular team sport, fit well with the concept of an army at war. A coordinated effort must be made by everyone if you're going to win your goal. Okay? As an example, an army will use a relay of men along a skirmish line at both ends as a flanking movement to get behind your enemy and win a battle. Now, similarly, my brother and I, Bob, in 1968, had somewhat of a relay movement. I was playing left field, and a ball was hit over my head. I had to run it down. I picked it up, fired it back into my brother, who was the shortstop, who fired it to the catcher, and we cut down the potential winning run. And later on, we won the game. Flanking relay movement. Now, that was a wonderful play, and my brother and I talk about it every time we get together, since he lives in St. Louis, Missouri right now. But another comparison between this is both baseball and war have their badges of honor. John Rossi tells us that the very brutality of early baseball, when brave men donned neither mask nor glove, and wore their bruises, shiners, and shin plasters as badges of honor. Now, in war, the shin plasters could mean that your leg is gone. The shiner, you may not be able to see again. And a bruise might be just a nick from a mini ball, and you get out alive. Still, baseball was accomplishing what nothing else could. It distracted you for at least a few hours and from all that insanity and brutality that was around you. There was an outfit, a private outfit, called the United States Sanitary Commission. They, among other things, provided, through their own donations, medicine, bandages, shoes to go into combat, religious counseling. But they also noted correctly that baseball was a good and excellent form of physical exercise and conditioning. The commission recommended that to preserve the health and morale, when practical, amusements, sports, and gymnastic exercises should be favored amongst the men. Baseball was one of those sports. Now, running and throwing and catching baseballs for hours will definitely get you in shape. And the troops, I mean, their exercise at one time was, well, they would drill and march, and then when they didn't march, they would drill. And I'm sure that instilled discipline and pride and a sense of purpose. But the conditioning that baseball provided was a new added dimension. Now, think about the way the Civil War was fought. There was some cavalry involved, and there was cannon, but usually men on one side lined up on one side of a field and charged to the other side of the field, up a hill, and when that didn't work, they charged back. And, you know, the better conditioning you were in, the better chance you had to stay alive. And, you know, baseball might have saved my life in some respects, too. If you think about it, if you're playing baseball, you're on a field. You're not on the streets. You're not in the alleys doing those things that can get you hurt, get you killed, get you put in prison. And I tell you, I could not wait for Saturday mornings to come. Find your buds, find your friends, and head to the field. You know, and it didn't matter if you didn't have enough to play a game. You made up your own rules, just like they did back, you know, in the day with the gentlemen. I mean, they made up a rule back in the day that to win a game, you had to score 100 runs. That's, didn't have time for that in the Civil War by now. So, and one of the rules, since we didn't have enough to play all the time, and that would take 18, and usually we had 5 or 6. If there was nobody in right field and you hit the ball there, you were out, and you had to go to the outfield, and I like to hit, so that increased your skills. I tell you, if you only had 2 people, like my brother and I in Missouri, well, one would pitch, one would hit, and we would run. And we used one of the rules from the old days where if you wanted to hit, then you had to hit the runner with the ball to get him out, and then you could hit. So that made for some interesting things with brothers. Now, Abner Doubleday, he was a major general and a hero of the Civil War. It was said that he fired the first cannon shot in defense of the Union at Fort Sumter. And he was credited with inventing baseball. Well, we know that's probably not true because it's a conglomeration of all sorts of people. But James Cushman tells us that Doubleday himself never claimed to be the father of baseball. Others claimed it for him. And that myth persists sometime today. But what better way to put a wonderful face on baseball than to have a hero of the Civil War say it's been invented? Now, whoever or however the game was created, it's given pleasure, pain, and solace to millions of people. And it's for this reason it's called a national pastime. And every spring, hope is renewed, and our lives have new meaning, and everything is right with the world. At least for a little while. The men of the Civil War benefited from the game, just as I did. And by playing or watching the game, nothing bad can happen on that day. There is no war, and everyone lives to play another day. And that is bullets and baseball. Thank you.